It's like a few minutes, people come in and
okay. So where's the chat? Oh, there it is there. Okay.
You need the mouse too,
right? You can use the mouse is right here if you don't use that.
Well, you need to look at it.
Yeah. She said she was gonna start.
So yeah, so Michael, she's gonna text all the questions.
Oh, she's gonna text them. Okay.
We said that it's not very friendly for us to be communicating with keyboard.
Okay.
So they're gonna
work on it. Or no way.
We're live, waiting for everyone to come in. Hello. Hello, early birds. Aha. Let's wait just a few more minutes.
Oh, yes, go copy. Kathy's here. Yasko is my favorite Opus One export manager in Japan.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. That's how I know the name.
Yeah.
How about that? That's great.
Yeah. We had lunch the other day at Farmstead.
How was it?
It was great. She got a steak for two people and basically polished it off.
That's pretty great.
Let's minimize that.
Sorry?
Let's minimize that window.
Here we go. Hello, everyone. I think we should kind of get into it. What do you think?
Yeah, sounds good. First of all, I'm not a head winemaker. I'm just a winemaker.
All right, we'll leave that one. Leave that one alone. Welcome, everyone. If you're just tuning in, this is the Benchmark Wine Group Raid Your Cellar today, featuring Opus One. And I'm really excited to be here. We're coming direct to you, as you can see behind us, from the cellar, from the barrel cellar, the Grand Chai, here at Opus One. I don't know how many people that are tuning in have been here before, but it's pretty spectacular. I wish we could take the camera and just kind of walk around and see what's going on over there. I have so many questions for you, which is going to be really...
Me?
Yeah, I have a lot of questions.
I thought you were talking to the audience.
No, I'm talking to you. I have a chance to, you know, so I'm new with Opus One, only, I think, 4 or 5 months now. So who am I? I'm Chris Blanchard, Master Sommelier. I'm the host for tonight. I'm also the Northwest Regional Sales Manager for this part of the country for Opus One. And I don't know about you, but you've been here... How many, 20?
I'm just entering, well, I'm about 21, 20 years, I'm in my 21st year.
21st year.
Yeah, I will have my 21st anniversary. I will become an adult on March 5th, 2022.
You get to try a glass of wine for the
exactly,
first time.
Exactly, at last. I've been waiting.
So I'm super fortunate tonight that we have three vintages that we're going to feature, which are available through Benchmark as well, starting with the, well, maybe... We'll see where we start. That was another question for you. Yeah. But we do have the 2008 vintage, the 2013, and the 2017. And the reason why I asked you how long you've been here is because I've been doing this quite a long time myself, at least in the wine business. And I still get very excited to have wine in front of me and to do a tasting.
Yeah.
And to do it with you is really spectacular because I think the only other time I'd ever been here is you invited me when I was at Red Restaurant in Yountville to do a tasting, I believe in the other room there.
Yeah, the wine library.
And we tried a number of different wines and I was really kind of blown away, you know, because I knew a little bit about Opus, but I didn't know what you were doing. I'm trying to imagine what year that would have been. That would have been early, maybe 2007.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. What I'm surprised at, how long have you been here?
Maybe 4 months.
Yeah, we have yet to taste together again and do a tour.
I know. Well, we did kind of when we first started.
Not really.
We tried a lot of wines.
We did taste a lot of wines. I don't want to mislead the audience.
Yeah.
But we never walked around and talked about the evolution of viticulture and winemaking.
I'm dying to spend time with you.
So we got to do that.
So and the reason I bring that up is because back then, I know that, I don't know how many vintages you had under your belt, possibly 6 or so or somewhere in that neighborhood. And I could always already see a gradual change, you know, coming from the 01 up through 6 or 7, whatever we tried. I think it was 7. And what's responsible for that? I mean, that's the number one question I get out in the market. Like,
yeah,
what are you doing?
Well, basically, we are we're making wines that, if you think about what the vision that Mr. Madavi and Baron Philippe had, it's basically three parts. To make a classic Bordeaux wine, a classic red wine with Bordeaux varieties. And secondly, to make a wine that people want to share with their friends and family. And thirdly, to attract people who want to come here and go beyond sustainability and become stewards of Opus One and the vineyards and the winery. So we're making classic wines, and that means we are focusing on making wines that give you a sense of time and place. Time being the season, a cool vintage like 2011 would be more herbal and have fresh fruit. A warmer season like 2008 would have some fresh fruit, but probably more ripe fruit. So that's a reflection of the weather in a given year. And then place is just an expression of where the fruit comes from, where the vines are planted. And that's going to come through in the mouthfeel of the wine. So if there's ever a thread of continuity across vintages, it's going to be in the mouthfeel. There could be a play on brightness. And sometimes you have a vintage like 11, which I mentioned is a cooler vintage. Basically, the pH and the acidity are in line with every vintage we make. But the perception of acidity, the brightness, that shows through is more pronounced, even though it's the same numbers. So that's why numbers don't really mean much.
So is that, it's a pH level, the acidity level, is that masked sometimes by the ripeness of the vintage or oak or anything like that? Or is it mostly naturally there?
I think it's probably different character, different compounds. So a riper vintage is going to have maybe more intense fruit. Mm-hmm. So that intensity of the fruit may mask the acidity a little bit. We also pick fairly early. We're probably the earliest in Oakville. I remember in 2010 we were picking. We started around the middle of the month anyway, 18th or 19th,
and September.
September, yes. Yeah. In a vintage that had so many different types of weather, and anyway, but I got a call from Warren Winiarski, with whom I worked for 6 years to the day at Stagsley Wine Cellars. If you don't count the 40 hours of work I did during the interviews and writing papers and stuff and doing tastings for him. And he asked me, I understand that you're picking grapes. And I said, yes. He said, are you picking red grapes? I said, well, yes, because that's what we do. And he said, well, we're still picking Sauvignon Blanc and maybe some Chardonnay. I think at Arcadia. And he asked me why we were picking, and I explained to him, and he said, well, I'm gonna go out tomorrow and taste the fruit, the red fruit, because we haven't been out yet. So we tend to be a little bit early because we want to make sure that we maintain, have good acidity, a good backbone in the wine to hold everything else together. And also because we do not acidulate. So what we bring in is what we have. And
Is that common still to acidulate? That was something from the 90s, right?
Yeah, people still acidulate, sure. How many people do, to what degree, I don't know, because I'm pretty much here. I do have a significant other who makes wine. She doesn't acidulate either.
And you can really taste it in those older wines, can't you?
I mean, yes, yeah. It has more of a metallic zing sometimes.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that was a thing.
Yeah.
And prior to coming here at Opus, did you have a good knowledge of Opus One? And did you?
I did because I knew of the project. I worked with George Shepler at Hublein Fine Wine Group. He was VP of marketing, and I was a viticulturist. And so I was very much I knew what was going on here. And then when I came, he was the co-CEO here. So he had left Hublein Fine Wine Group, I forgot what year, but he was the first co-CEO representing the Rothschild family. And so I was pretty much aware of it. And actually, one of the exercises I had to do for Warren Winiarski was to taste Cast 23, their Reserve Chardonnay and Napa Valley Sauvignon Blanc. And I decided to Pallmeyer was really popular at the time with Chardonnay. Uh-huh. So I grabbed a bottle of, I bought a bottle of Chardonnay Pallmeyer, but George has given me a bottle of Opus One. And so I put those to have comparisons so I could bounce between styles with warm.
Was that one of the first wines you think you tasted from Opus One?
No, I tasted wines before.
Yeah, before.
Because of George.
Yeah. And what did you think? I mean, were you pretty excited? It was a pretty unique project 40 plus years ago.
Yeah. And you know, when they first planted the vineyard up in front, which we've pulled, but we still have some vineyards in the east blocks that are the same spacing. They were 1 meter between the vines and 6 feet between the rows. And the head height was about waist high. But everyone thought, oh my gosh, that's so tight. You know, that's so dense. And it's kind of like when you think about when I was a kid, I grew up in when the Beatles came on the stage, the world stage. And I remember it, we all thought they had long hair. And now you look back at them and they look like, you know, choir boys. Right. And that's the way those vines look. They're like choir boys.
That's
choir vines. You know, so they weren't that tight. But
yeah, I remember driving past here and just seeing these small, you know, the height. I always wonder what is that? I mean, obviously in France that you would grow it lower to the ground to absorb heat. I thought, well, California, that's not right. You shouldn't do that, right? Because it's...
Yeah, but if you look at it this way, we plant, now our current spacing is 1 meter between the vines and 1.2 meters or 4 feet between the roots. So 39 inches by 4 feet. And the head height is fairly low. And in California, we have the soils have good organic material and we've got plenty of sunshine. And so we want to limit the amount of storage for carbohydrates from 1 year to the next. So we also don't do cordon train vines anymore, the permanent arms. Mm-hmm. With spur prunes, we use Guyot, which is a head train vine with canes. So we further limit the amount of carbohydrates that go from 1 year to the next. And so that, yes, you're absolutely, it's true. In France, they have the albedo factor where they're looking at direct sunlight on the grapes, reflected sunlight, and then diffused. Here, we're not looking for that so much. And just like in France, usually, I know in Bordeaux, we feel the humidity during the growing season, because it's wetter there. Yeah. They get more rainfall in the summer. And here we do get some humidity because of the, you know, evapotranspiration. So, so there's a couple of questions.
Yeah, there. I can keep going on that, but
let's see.
Go ahead, sorry.
Perth, Australia, oh, great.
I'm gonna go up to the top, do you mind?
Hi, Perth.
Perth, Australia, that's fantastic. Yeah. John from Aldo Song, that's great.
Yeah, great. Yeah.
We're just saying hello to people. Parker House, Steamboat Landing, Vancouver.
I wonder if they're responsible for the Parker Rolls.
What? You never been there to Boston to the Parker House, the hotel?
I have not. No.
Oh.
I don't go to Boston very often.
You know who used to work there? I'm sorry.
Who?
Malcolm X was a dishwasher.
Oh, really?
Yeah. What is it? Mao Zedong worked there also in the kitchen.
I've got to get there.
Oh, that's incredible.
You think they'll let me wash dishes? I'll pretend like I have no money.
That's where Jackie Kennedy and John used to go and sit at the table.
For sure, I'm going to say I don't have any money so I can wash dishes and say I have something in common with them.
So, yeah.
Drinking the 2008 blackberry pie with beef, blood, and iron. Deep minerality with Islay iodine notes. Incredible. Definitely understood.
Scott's reference.
That's great.
Oh, from David Parker, of course.
Yep.
Thank you so much. I guess we should get into it. Just
a minute. We should start with the 08.
Okay, is that what you do?
Because that's I always like to go oldest to youngest because it's like when you go to a family reunion, you visit the old folks first because they're relaxed. By the time the children have been running around, almost knocking them over, they're a little frayed.
Yeah,
and they're and they're also more subtle. So I want to go with an older wine first to try to understand the subtleties of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, 08's not that old, but regardless, the older the vintage, the more subtle it's going to be usually, and you want to be able to pick those nuances up and not start with the youngest wine, which could mask the characters of the older
wine. I'm so glad I asked. That's such a great
answer. Are you a young to old or an old to young?
I like old to young too, for the same reason. If you always should respect someone and speak with them for a while and get to know them a little bit. But and then the other question I had is, Do you decant these wines? Because we just opened them up.
Typically, I like to just splash as we're going to be here for a while.
Yeah.
You know, just when you pour, just pour it so that it's splashing, but not splashing outside
the glass.
Into the glass.
Yeah. If you're in a restaurant, most people will make a show out of it and they'll bring it out mm-hmm. and do the whole thing. Are there particular vintages maybe that?
Sure. If we know that there's a deposit in the wine.
Okay. Yeah. Right.
And plus, I'll tell you, if there's a Somm who's really excited about decanting or
right.
really, you know, is really wants to decant, I'll say yes, because I want them to have a good time as well. And unless it's a wine that I think, if it's a really old wine and I think it's going to maybe break the wine or it won't last as long in the glasses as
sure,
yeah. then I'll say, well, maybe we can not decant, or you can decant and then pour right away. But I always like to ask Somms what wines they think go well with the food in their restaurant, because they know better than I do. And also I like to respect with, you know, any showmanship they like to, or show personship they want to.
I mean, as a restaurant person for many years, I would always, you know, take the bottle mm-hmm. and present it, and I'd walk through the dining room with it in my serviette like this, you know, like the king was coming through the dining room, right? People looking, like, whoa, you know, who's ordering that?
Yeah,
want to see where it is.
Yeah.
And then it would inspire other sales as well.
Yes.
People would start buying it if they could, but competing.
You know, I worked at Bully Vineyard, and the back label, I don't know if you remember, had a red stripe.
Uh-huh.
And so whether you had the front, usually Tom Selfridge said, let's have the back label showing, because that was distinctive for BV. And it would actually do the same thing you just described.
Uh-huh.
People would see it and they, oh, that's Bully Vineyard. We better get some private reserve.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing how that works.
It does.
And then I always tell people, even if you don't need to decant it, it feels so good, especially if you're buying a special bottle. You come to the table and you do the whole show. Oh my, this is amazing.
Yeah,
it's ceremonial. Yeah.
If you got the candle, I mean, life's good.
Not the iPhone flashlight through the.
Not the iPhone flashlight. But that's also, you can have the candle on the iPhone flashlight, you know.
I only use that for concerts.
Yeah.
Anyhow, so yeah, we should, I think we figured that out. Get into the 08. And there's another question, which it was a question I was going to ask right now too. I mean, different wine styles, you know, it's cyclical. And I was just up in Seattle and people were saying, well, now you guys are in vogue. Yeah. It goes up and down because your wines are in balance and mm-hmm. they're not, you know, over oaked or alcohol or anything like what balances, right? And that's becoming more of a, fortunately, becoming more of a thing.
You know? Yeah.
So it's, and somebody had asked, had you always picked early, or is that something you've started doing?
No, we've always picked a little bit earlier than others, but we really moved to an early pick in 2010. I mean, that's when we really picked early. And that was because it was a very cool vintage. And then it got very warm at the end of August 25th. We had a warm spell. And then a week later, we had another heat spell. And then the middle of September, our facilities manager asked if we could find one ton of grapes, even though he asked, when are you going to be picking? Said, probably around the 5th or 6th of October. That's what, because we work with 5-year averages on paper. And then he had asked, can you find a ton of grapes so that we can calibrate and make sure our optical sorter works, as we just purchased it. I said, sure, we can find a ton. We went out and we found 20 tons. I mean, like that. And I was really baffled by that. Why is so much fruit ready now? And I asked Natalie Giray to bring all of the weather data, and we looked at that, and it was very clear why, because it was a cool year, and the average temperature was in the 83, 84, which is perfect for photosynthesis. So the vines in a hot year, their vines are like us. Mm. You know, when it gets to 84, 80s, we really enjoy it. It gets to the high 80s, we start to get a little tired. 95, they don't. They close their stomata and go take a nap, and so do we. Mm-hmm. That year they didn't. And so all the flavor and aroma compounds were being developed by the berries. Having said that, at that time, we found the 20 tons, but there was a heat spill coming, and I said, well, maybe there's more that's ready than we see. So we walked walked the rows in all four estate vineyards, and we put the vines and fruit into one of three categories. It's ready to pick, it's not ready to pick, and the vines need some water to get through the heat spell. The fruit's not ready to pick, and the vines don't need water to get through the heat spell. And that first weekend, including Sunday, we picked 18% of our entire vintage. And then we didn't pick the following week for 4 or 5 days because of the heat spell. But anyway, that's to answer that question. That's where we really jumped and started to pick very early. It's kind of like we're the type of people that as soon as cherry season opens, we go to the fruit stand and buy the cherries. We know they're not probably going to be great, right. But we know that the fruit's not going to be maybe super ripe, but we want a little bit of that herbal note and fresh fruit, like a cherry off of a tree. And then the rest is going to be ripe fruit like cherry jam. So that's the difference between fresh and ripe fruit.
You also said something interesting in that certain years that the fruit is really good. Like you said, this year, I recall, right? The cherries were pretty spectacular.
Yeah.
Peaches and things like that. Is that just because of heat, or is there other things involved in that?
This year?
It's been hot.
Yeah, it's been hot. Usually, I think you'll always find good cherries somewhere.
Yeah.
And probably it's terroir related as well. I mean, site related. So you're probably going to consistently where you have great cherries, like Rainier cherries from Washington, mm-hmm. they're always going to be great.
Yeah, that's true.
And if you know the orchards, like there's some orchards over in Winters, mm-hmm. California, there you always know the cherries are going to be great there. Gilroy, where I came from, mm-hmm. there's certain orchards I know that will always be good. So I think that has a lot to do with in the weather and when they decide to pick.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, I remember tomatoes were a big thing. Winemakers were always trading tomatoes in good years and kind of equated to that.
Yeah.
To the wine, but there, and it does bring up somebody else also, it does bring up a great question about the 17, because as I remember, as I understand it, it was very hot.
Yes.
I mean, like super crazy hot. And then you had mentioned that 95 degrees is sort of the detente, the cutoff for what happens at 95 degrees.
Well, the vines just, they can't evapotranspire. They can't get enough water. The leaves convert liquid water to a vapor to cool themselves.
Okay.
And that going from a liquid to a vapor is it creates energy to pull water and nutrients up through the plant. So in 2017, we had lots and lots and lots of rain, 16 to 17 in the winter. Mm-hmm. So there's plenty of water in the soil. So that also was being dealt with by the plants. And then we had, it was warm, but the season after that was, it rained right up until March. So I think bloom was delayed by about 2 weeks. So it got off to a little bit late start, relatively warm or a warm season, punctuated with some heat spells. And we started picking on the 5th of September that year.
Wow.
We finished on the fires came on the 8th. And then we didn't pick for a few days and we continued to pick, but all of the fruit that was from the 5th of September to the 8th of October was fine for the blend. And actually some of the others were as well.
After?
Yeah. So we picked from 3 until 9 in the morning and we could see I'm smiling now, but it wasn't very fun. It wasn't a lot of fun at the time, but we could see in the hillside.
Orange glow.
The fire, even some fire coming on the two hills over. So
it's just awful.
I would drive through the Walnut Drive neighborhood and just write a quick report to all the neighbors just saying everything's cool, you know, the fire's not there, and Graham McDonald, your sprinkler's still working on your house, he had one on his roof, you know. So, and the folks in San Francisco, so they didn't have to come up and make sure their phone booth was That phone booth from London, you know, did you ever see that red phone booth?
Yeah,
it's still there. It's not on fire.
But so, and again, when I talk about 17, it's, I know we're tasting older, but the 17 was so warm, and I would expect these wines that are ultra ripe, but did the sugar sort of retract or were they stuck for a little bit?
Yeah, they were stuck for a while. But I don't think that the sugars were not, they stalled. And sometimes they go backwards. I think we got a little bit of that in 17. Mm. But yeah, we, you know, like I said, I try to see what the Somm likes to do. So I'm going to amuse you and go to the 17. I find with the 17, there's a really beautiful mocha character in addition to the fruit in the aroma. And I find that also the creaminess on the palate is mocha-like.
Yeah.
There's a chocolate character.
Or like powdered cocoa in a way. Mm-hmm. Or...
And you know, a lot of times notes of espresso or chocolate come from the barrel. And just to go, because I love going on frontage roads and tangents.
Front, yeah.
So we have two barrels right behind us that were made by two young women. I had never met a female cooper. And I went into Tonnerre Bordelais a few years ago, and there's this young woman, just bundle of energy, really enthusiastic, excited about, she was an apprentice and she was going to school. And I told her, because barrel making is like an assembly line. You know, somebody raises the barrel, another bends the staves, then they pass it off to somebody who toasts it, and on and on. It's like an assembly line.
Right, yeah.
And I said, when you make your first barrel, we're going to buy it. And and then when I went back 2 years later, another woman was there. Now, both of these women, mind you, won this, they were named the best apprentice cooper in all of France.
And there's an award for that?
Yes, in 18 and 19. And we had, that's what's written on the barrel. It's it has their name and the year that they won the the master apprentice cooper. Yeah, and now there's a third. We were just there in June. Huh. And there's yet a third woman. And so she heard the others, and I said, well, I knew that's why there was, you know, space for three barrels in this window.
That's crazy.
But we put in new barrels in this room every year, but those three, well, those two, and then when hers comes, will be there until they fall apart. So it's
wow,
the only,
I never noticed that.
Yeah. So
that's awesome.
And I love the mouthfeel and the finish on the 17.
There's a question which I was going to ask as well regarding canopy management. Just, and historically, you know, if you go back to 96 and 97, where, you know, there was the sprawl until then, and then people started opening up the canopy or the leaves a little bit, thinning things down with more sunlight, and that created these riper, bigger wines that got big awards and scores and everything.
Yeah.
And then things just started going crazy. What's been going on lately with that?
I tried to, when I first came here, when I was at Stagsy Point Cellars, we would remove all the laterals and just leave the leaves and some laterals in the cluster zone to protect, like act as little sun umbrellas. Here I tried, I didn't do it everywhere because I wasn't sure how it would work here, but when we removed all the laterals here, it was too much. And so we go through and we just kind of pluck out some laterals to give some dappled light. Mm-hmm. And then we hedge. We hedge early, actually. We hedge during flowering, which it's like an old wives' tale. You shouldn't be hedging during flowering or giving water because it will upset the bloom. But I find what it does is it actually facilitates, on the longer shoots, those photosynthates go down to the flowers. And allows the shorter shoots to catch up.
And when you say hedging, is that just what it sounds like?
Yeah, topping. Yeah. I'm going to sneeze.
Oh, yeah.
Excuse me.
Sound more like a
excuse me, studio audience. So we hedge, and then that forces laterals, and we keep the laterals in the cluster zone, and we will do some removal of laterals, but we also box hedge, so it's like a nice hedge.
And that's not just for looks, because it does look
pretty. No, it's not for
it looks. Looks very pretty.
No, yeah. it's for to take care of the vines.
You don't see that
there's
often.
Only so many leaves we want per shoot.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah.
So like in 17, there's a question here about major canopy management 17. Mm-hmm. So I think we answered the question.
Yes.
When we pick September 5th through October 9th or 10th. But we would, we left more leaves per shoot. We did this in 2010 as well, because we knew there's a lot of water in the soil because of the heavier rainfall. We wanted the water in the lower horizons to be evapotranspired. And then we would go in and hedge when we saw the vines were getting a little bit stressed. The way you can tell the vine is stressed is you measure the stem water potential of the vine, and that's like taking someone's blood pressure. But there are certain varieties that don't show stress at like certain people that don't show stress at a high blood pressure. Mm-hmm. Certain vines like Cabernet Franc don't show stress at high water stress. Oh, and nice. But so you go and you touch the leaves. Would you turn this way?
Oh, sure.
You touch their leaves and you feel, are they warmed? Are they folding? You look for keys. So that's why it's very important to not just have a technician go out and walk the vineyard, but teach them the signs that they should be looking for, teach the vineyard team the signs they should be looking for, and then actually go out yourself.
Yeah.
So, and then we ended up hedging to 14 to 16 leaves because that's what we need to ripen two clusters of fruit. Ah,
so interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, this is great. And I didn't mean to jump ahead to the 17, but there
that's okay. I'm right behind you.
Yeah. I mean, can we go back to the 8? Is that, or is it,
sure.
Did we miss our opportunity?
No, not at all.
Some respect for the 08.
Yeah.
And the reason I ask is because it's always good to hear a little bit. You know, the one thing is there's always these behind the scenes stories. And when you present wine to somebody, you can say the same thing over, oh, this is black or it's got low tan or high tan, yeah, or whatever. It's so boring. But what really I think sells wines, when the most important thing is just sort of behind the scenes story of what the harvest was like or what happened.
Yeah. And so the 2008, there's some blackberry. And
yeah.
I'm just trying to explain yeah. your leg. No, 2008 was interesting because we had the inversion layer. So hot air rises and it stops at a certain point, it hovers. And then we turn on wind machines that before it freezes, mm-hmm. turn on wind machine, the cold air will be blown up to mix with the warm air in the inversion layer. Comes back down, and that's how we protect the vines. Mm-hmm. In 2008, the inversion layer was much higher, and the wind machines, even though they were blowing, that cold air did not mix with warm air. It was like, it's like me trying to dunk a basketball. It's not going to happen. And so just like I would miss I probably couldn't even touch the net. And the wind machine, that airflow was not mixing at all with the inversion layer. So we had a widespread frost damage mm-hmm. in 2008. So that was on the succulent green shoots. So that had some impact.
What's the impact besides volume is not as great, but
it actually kills the green material, the shoots.
Oh, wow. And then how does it, is that sort of the hens and chicks things or?
No, you're looking for the secondary buds to push,
okay.
So you get another shoot okay. growing.
Right.
And then it was also the second year of my obsession with dry farming. So with the second year I'm obsessed with dry farming. We have frost. And then it was the year Mr. Mondavi passed away. It was the year Jean Dangeois worked with me for 8 years. He had done two internships before I came. I convinced him to come for a third. He said, well, I've already been to Opus and I'm going to go somewhere else. And I said, well, you may have been to Opus, but you never worked with me.
And who is that?
Jean Dangeois was an intern who I'd read his report in when he was here in 2000 or 1999. I read his report on a phenolics project. And I knew that so I came to Opus and there was an established Cellar crew. And it was hard for me to connect with the Cellar crew because they were resistant to a new person. Mm-hmm. And whenever I tried to get close to them, it was like me trying to kiss a turtle. The head would just go back into the shell. But I knew that he was not a threat to them because they all liked him and he was just an intern.
Yeah.
So I thought he would be a great connection or facilitator between me and the Cellar crew. And so I convinced him to come and work with us. And then we created a full-time position for him. And basically I said, work with me and we'll look at my job as like a pie. And you'll always get a slice of the pie. Sometimes you'll get a whole pie. Depends on the project and what your knowledge is. And I push and I'll challenge you. And, you know, if you stay with me, you're going to be at a different level in whenever you want to leave than you would be if you went somewhere else right away. And he bought it. And so then they asked me permission to recruit him for Clermion. And I said, of course, but I need to have him here for one more year. And that was 08. But then I I suggested that, I said, you should go to Mouton for 2 weeks during harvest in 08 so that you can be ready for the transition when you go there in 09. And it turned out it was the two busiest year for your two busiest weeks for us in 2008, which was actually a blessing in disguise, because it really showed us, can our team rise to the occasion? And they did. So, you know, confirmed promotions I wanted to make, and allowed him to see Mouton and what they do there, and then Clermont as well. So anyway, that was 08. And then it was the second year that we started in 2007 to co-ferment every berry of Petit Verdot with Cabernet Sauvignon, meaning that we would put in the same tank Petit Verdot grapes and Cabernet Sauvignon grapes, and not just any Cabernet Sauvignon grapes, our best. And why did we do that? Because when we would make the Petit Verdot wine and try to blend it with our Cabernet Sauvignon, there, we could only put in so much. And then it would become, then the blend would become very rustic and harsh. And so I thought I was born at 2:53 in the morning, and I often wake up between 2:30 and 3 going through my issues. And my issue, and this is in 07 actually, was how can we get more Petit Verdot into the blend, because we had poor set in Cabernet. And one morning I woke up and I said, we'll make fruit cocktails. Petit Verdot and Cabernet Sauvignon in the same tank. There will be this base chemistry or juice chemistry that was harmonious, and they won't know the difference. And it was amazing. Huh. It was
in 07,
we started 08. This is 8% Petit Verdot, this one.
That's really high.
It's high.
Yeah. It doesn't taste like it at all.
Amazing. It's because of the harmony that's introduced from co-fermentation. When we blend Petit Verdot with Cabernet Sauvignon at Opus One, it's like a dog meeting a cat in the street. They fight. Uh-huh. But when we blend them as grape berries, like kittens meeting puppies, they grow up loving each other. And you get this really, you can't tell that there's more Petit Verdot in here.
Not at all. No. I'm really surprised by that. Because most wines that would take it over, for sure. Yeah. That's interesting. And I remember asking you a question whether everything is fermented separately, but it's a pretty hard question to answer, I'm sure, because there's so many different things going on. And I remember 08 when it came out, it was just incredibly lush and lovely and beautiful, and it hasn't really aged that much at all. I mean, it still has a character to it.
Yeah,
it's just beautiful, and in the nose, there's so much going on with it. It's incredible. I remember when we tasted it, you know, a few months back, and
yeah.
What do you think?
I love it. I you know, I like 7. 7 was a vintage that was a little riper than I really wanted. It's a real expression of what we can do in Oakville, California, in a warm year. I found 8 to be a more restrained. I find 8 to be a restrained version of 7. So I like this. It's like a subtle 7.
Yeah. And it's funny because, again, when we tasted through the 07, I was really kind of surprised, because that's a big, full, rich, you know, wine for most people. And the Opus One was so amazing and beautiful and delicate and not overdone. And it was really excellent for me. I was very happy about that. And I do sort of like the meaty character of the 08. I think David had mentioned something about
he was in Scotland or something.
There you go. Yeah, blackberry pie. Beef, blood, iron.
Yeah.
The blood thing always kind of gets me. I know it's a good descriptor.
Yeah, it is. But, you know.
Maybe like a steak type or lamb or something.
Yeah. We did farm biodynamically one of our estate vineyards at 35% of our property for 11 years. So the beef blood, you know, I can see that. And in 08 was one of the years, so.
So what happened? What was that about? Because that's a very interesting story too. You gave it a try. Is that correct?
Yeah, I was really curious about biodynamics. So why did we start biodynamics? It wasn't because I had this.
You want to be cool?
It's not that I wanted to be cool or do something. It wasn't a philosophical choice. It was basically, it kind of was. I felt that we were getting to a stage where we were where we could become complacent, where we could just like sit back on our laurels. So I asked myself, what could we do that would put the vines at risk and get everyone to really focus, you know, just like hit the reset button and become very focused. And I said, biodynamics. And so we tried it. It was theoretically a 7 to 10 year experiment.
Did you go full on with the horn and the
Oh, everything. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. I grew up in a dairy, so I didn't have any issues with it.
Okay.
Packing the horns.
Right. But it's not that. It's just really, does that work? I mean, or did you actually see? I know that the soul of a wine, you can really, really tell a wine that's made with love and like great food in New Orleans or something. You can feel the love in that food.
Yeah.
So I always thought biodynamics maybe was more of that, just bringing attention.
I felt that our team was already very attentive to the vines. Mm-hmm. I think we got more of an impact on the texture and the mouthfeel of the wine when we finally had isolated native yeast from all of our vineyards. So we went out to each vineyard and tried to isolate a wild yeast that would be used to ferment the grapes coming from that vineyard. What happened with biodynamics and why we didn't continue is that when I had lured this consultant, this fellow who wasn't a consultant before, but he worked at the Josephine Porter Institute. And he reminded me of, if you had, you know, the Cheez-It commercials where they have the cracker and the cheese and they slam them together. He reminded me if Donovan, the folk singer, was a cracker and Arlo Guthrie was the cheese. He reminded me of a blend of those two guys, and he really embodied biodynamics to me. And I convinced him to come out and visit us, and then convinced him to come be a consultant for us. And he was fantastic. Anyway, so at one point he called me, or he called me because I remember being stumped. He said, "Michael, I'm a little bit concerned because we have a conflict." "What's the conflict, Matthew?" "Well, we came out, we saw you hedged and you dropped through. You cluster thinned, or you berry thinned in some cases. And in biodynamics encourages vigor and abundance. And you're going against that." And I said, "Shoot." I said, no, you're looking at it from the wrong perspective. Your vigor and abundance is our intensity and concentration. Same thing. It's just looking at it from a different perspective." Yeah. And he actually believed in me. No, but now I believe that too. But all those things, that attention, when you talk to the vines, when the guys are singing in the vineyard, when you're touching the vines, when you're walking through, I think that has an impact.
Oh, I do too.
And having the yeast that come from, you know, we isolated a wild yeast off the sappy part of an oak tree behind the winery. And we call that the squirrel because it came from an oak tree.
I was going to ask you about that. Yeah.
We've got a wolf, we've got a coyote, we've got a shwed or an owl, and we have a hog, and we're looking for a monkey. So
I kind of explained that on my recent trip to Seattle, but I couldn't really do it. And somebody asked me the question I've been hoping they didn't ask me, like, how exactly do you do that? Like, how do you isolate the native yeast?
So what we do is the first ones, the wolf, the coyote, and the shwed, and the dog, actually, you go out in the vineyard. We had a French microbiologist, puts on her latex gloves, goes out with a pair of snips and a bottle of alcohol, Ziploc baggie, and she snips off a cluster, puts it into the baggie, labels it, crushes it. She put it behind my former office, which is over, you know, in the arcade. Uh-huh. I think it's either Greg or or Scott's office. Behind there is a storage room. So we had 50 Ziploc baggie fermentations going that in a warm storage room.
So many fermentations in the baggie.
Mm-hmm. And then we eliminated 35 right away because they, after X number of days, they had too much residual sugar, or they had volatile acidity, like the aroma of a nail polish or vinegar. And so the 35 wiped off the board right away. We tasted the 15, we liked 6 of them. So that was in 2012. So that year until the 13 vintage was ready, we kept, so you isolate this on an auger, on a plate, petri dish, and then you take a colony and you streak that, and then you flame your wand again, and then you do it another way, flame it so you're killing anything on it, and then you, another one, and you're purifying the culture.
And then it grows.
And then, so then you pluck that one off and you grow it on something else. You keep purifying it.
Wow.
And then in 2013, we brought in 12 tons of fruit. We had 6 2-ton tanks. We did 6 2-ton fermentations with each of the 6 yeasts that we had chosen. At the same time, we sent samples of the yeast off to a lab to see if they were truly wild. And that's where we found we had 2 wolves, 3 coyotes, and a dog. So the wolves live in the wild, so those 2 yeasts were purely wild. The coyote will live in the wild, but they'll come into your neighborhood and have your chicken or your cat for dinner. So they had shared a allele with certain commercial yeast, and the dog was a commercial yeast from the Rhone. Huh. So we like 1 wolf, 1 coyote, and then the second wolf we called Funky because it had kind of a swampy tide pool barnyard aroma, but not Britannomyces barnyard. And we said, let's just wait and see how it goes. And then later the odors became aromas and the mouthfeel was fantastic. And we named it after, I wanted to name it after this French microbiologist whose name still is Anaïs Couette-Cassou. And you know how when you focus too much on something, you can't see?
Yeah,
the result. One day I just kind of looking at her name and I was really relaxed and boom, it floated off the page. I took the C from Cassou and put it in front of Huet, and we had the word chouette, which is an owl. Or chouette is also means great in French, like, oh, c'est chouette ça. Oh, that's really great. Oh,
right.
And so we had our chouette, our owl, the wolf, the coyote, and then we had the hog came from a juice keg, and then the squirrel came from a sappy part of an oak tree.
And that's just amazing. And now it's 80% wild fermentation.
No, 100%.
100%.
100%.
Going into the right now, you're using all native yeast.
Yeah. So it was 90, I think in 2020, no, 2019, I believe it was 96% our.
That's great.
Our native yeast, our wild yeast, isolated yeast, and 4% was what came in on the skins, like a normal maybe yeast fermentation.
And so what does that do for the wine?
I think it changes, gives some more subtle nuances to the aroma, and definitely in the mouthfeel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so what year was that really predominant? Like, could you really tell?
Well, the first year we started in, 13, it wasn't too much. I think it was 14 or 17% of our entire vintage. And then in 14, I think it was 25%. Then it went to 37%. Then we had contamination. We hit the reset button and we were about 15 or 17%, 20% again. And then now we're 100%.
So we should look at the 13 as well. Yeah. I know it's totally fine. It's very interesting to hear that. But
how are we doing time?
All right.
We're getting close.
So the 13 is, somebody gave it to me in a blind tasting. I almost thought it was older, because it has all these great sort of, so there's some earthy aromas to it, but it's such a, today it's really intense and shining and complex. And
to me, it's like the 16 is like this too. There's a lot of densely packed layers.
Yeah.
There's not a heaviness or a density in that way, but there's a lot of like a millefeuille, you know.
Yeah, I was just gonna say a cake.
You're looking at it and then all of a sudden you're seeing where you can't tell one layer from the next, but you still have this layers from the beginning to the end.
And 13, most 13s and I taste are almost still so massive that they're not even ready to drink. But this is definitely more ready to drink. It's still a big wine, but it doesn't have the kind of tannins that a lot of other 13s can have.
I think most of that is due to the fact that we don't want to leave fingerprints on the glass, nor do we want to leave footprints in the vineyard. It's not about me. It's not about my team. It's about the place and about the 2 gentlemen that founded the winery. So when we're out, when we're tasting the fruit, we're looking for the skins to the flavors to be fresh fruit to ripe fruit, the skins to be shredding or melting, not astringent nor gumming up like a like spent gum, balling up in your mouth. You want them to shred and melt, but not just disappear.
Yeah,
because that's going to be a little bit too tannic. And then also with the Coopers are a huge factor because they are like a they have to make a barrel that is like a pedestal upon which we put the wine. It holds up, supports the wine. It's there's some nuances coming from the barrel, but when we release the wine, you shouldn't see it as a big pop of oak. It should just be very well integrated and complete, and it should be ready to drink, at least ready to approach when the wine is released, so that you can watch the evolution over time. But I think again, it always comes down to balance. You know, from the way we plant the vines, to the way we treat the vines and the fruit, to the way we make the wine, it's all about balance.
Yeah, it's incredibly balanced. Like I say, even in a wine like 13, with that kind of structure, the wines are really singing today. I mean, when I first prepared them, I was really excited. And have you seen the 13 change quite a bit, like through the evolution?
It's been a slow evolution. It went from being really, you know, the primary fruit, like primary colors, to like red and blue became purple. You know, they start to merge, and in the mouthfeel, of course, evolves. I think typically our wines are now usually, I don't remember if we even find 8. I know we didn't find 7, but egg white finding on 13 and 17 were probably 3 egg whites per barrel. You know, that's enough to get everything to settle and to just smooth the edge. So let's see, there's do you find by the moon and all of that? No, because we're not doing biodynamics anymore, but David, what we did do is I would look at when we were racking. I didn't tell them what I was up to, but I wanted to know how many barrels it took to fill a tank when we were doing the final racking to get ready for bottling, and noticed that on fruit days, it would take fewer barrels to fill a tank than like a leaf day where there would be, and also the moon, where's the moon? Because the moon has gravitational pull. And even though we don't really notice it, but there may be a little bit more fluffiness to the leaves when the moon's full and pulling gravitational pull, whereas opposed to when it's far away, they're more compact. So we notice subtle differences like that, but no, we didn't live or find by the moon and all of that.
Another question on French and American oak. I don't believe there's any American.
Yeah, there's plenty of American oak. All these frames here and the doors are American oak. Now that's not, I would never say that American oak is not good, because we see so many examples of wines that were aged in American oak that are great wines. It just so happens that the philosophy here, the choice of oak is French. Tight grain, it has to come from French forests. And we give a lot of leeway and a lot of creativity to the Coopers, because they come every year and they taste with us. They know what we're after. And so it's really up to them. I think of them as being a partner. And I believe that they make better decisions when they're cutting down trees or making barrels than I do.
Well, good. And then finally, I know we talked a little bit about the 17, but that seems to be in such a great space too. I mean, with the acidity level and so bright and
And again, that year, you know, September 5th was early to start picking. I think we picked on the 5th of September also in 08.
So early, it's amazing. And then one quick question: I always thought, why is there a greater percentage of Cabernet in some particular vintages? Do you find that in warmer vintages, there's more percentage of Cabernet, or there is no correlation particularly?
No, it's when we make the blends, it's all blind. And so we make the blends, and then when we're done, then we look at volumes and what the percentage breakdown is. Now, mind you, every vintage from 79 through 2020 would have could be labeled Cabernet Sauvignon. mm-hmm. except for one. Because all you have to have is 85% of a given variety to call it that variety.
75.
Is it 75? Yeah, 75. You're absolutely correct. You're absolutely correct.
Which is kind of crazy.
Yeah, it is crazy. See, I couldn't believe it. That's why I'm 25. Yeah, right. But in 2011, we were at, I think, 71%. We were 71%. So that's the first vintage where we could not call it Cabernet Sauvignon if we had wanted to, but we don't want to. So
yeah,
it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So it's neither here nor there.
So but
interesting, 70, talking about the 11, uh-huh. 71% Cabernet Sauvignon,
wow.
11% Merlot, 9% Petit Verdot, and then Cab Franc and Malbec.
Most unusual blend ever.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So, yeah.
Funny. Well, I know that David had a question. Mm-hmm. I just found out. Yeah. Oh, there we go. Hand is raised. Let's see, David, if you could unmute yourself. And come along. There we go.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Well, thank you so much, Chris and Michael. This is probably the classiest radio cellar we've ever had, with the jackets, ties, and barrel room in the background. Opus One has a special place in my heart. We used to provide grapes to Robert Mondavi back when he was starting this project. My question is, Michael, and you've mentioned a few of the things, the experiment with biodynamic techniques, the wild yeast. How would you say the philosophy of winemaking and viticulture has evolved over the 42 years that Opus One has been a product? How has the product itself changed? And maybe to the question of Petit Verdot, what is that bringing to these wines?
Well, you know, the early vintages were made by Lucien Sieno from Mouton. He was in the twilight of his career with Tim Mondavi, who was at the beginning of his career. And so there was a heavy influence by Lucien Sieno on the wine. And he was looking for lower alcohol, you know, mm-hmm. and also in California those years, really up until the late 80s, fruit was being picked based on sugars and actually grape contracts, actually even into the early 90s, grape contracts. If a grape contract called for, I can't remember what it was, it was 22.5 or 22.7. If you went above that or below that, you would be penalized. But fortunately, it wasn't on a load by load basis. It was based on all the loads that you brought in from your vineyard. So you could look for an average. And then Michael Martini always made harvest decisions based on flavor, taste. And then that really became what we were doing in the beginning of the late 80s and then in the 90s. Mm-hmm. So that was that. And so it evolved. And then also you think about the fact that 86 was the year that they first detected phylloxera, and it was in a vineyard in Rutherford. And then of course people were denying that it was that, you know, because went through the usual grief curve, denied, then got angry, and then rolled up their sleeves and did something about it. So he had all these different opportunities to plant different rootstock and try to match the rootstock to the site, and also to look at different, maybe not so much different varieties, but maybe not plant varieties that didn't really make sense, mm-hmm. Having them planted in St. Helena or Rutherford. Let them go a little bit further south, and then clones. There was a lot of clonal work that we did at Beaulieu. And so you could accentuate, what I feel is that phylloxera caused us to reevaluate what we were doing. And I feel that the overall quality of wine in Napa increased due to phylloxera.
In a way. Yeah.
And then because of all of the sharing of information and tasting clone wines, et cetera, people were able to really choose what they felt was right for them and accentuated the differences. So increases in quality and an increase in differentiation between, but then the young vines were cleaner, very efficient. And then you had these higher sugars and people became infatuated with these big fat, juicy, high alcohol wines. And that was dominant. And then you had certain critics that were really rewarding people for excess and
chasing the points.
Which is fine.
You talked about balance, and it's certainly there. And the new world, old world influences are both very, very clear still in the wine. I congratulate you. This is just, it remains one of the iconic wines of the new world. This is, these are just all fantastic.
Thank you, David.
Yeah, I we'll wrap it up. It really is incredible how you can really taste the two countries together like that. It's just phenomenal all the way through from every vintage.
Yeah.
It's really neat. And on that note, we should probably finish up if that sounds good. I appreciate your time. I know you have to move through, but thank you so much for being here on the Raid Your Cellar. I'm trying to think if there's anything in particular I need to say, but your time is very valuable. And every time I spend time
Everyone on this call is very valuable.
I always learn something incredible. So I appreciate
That's great. I really enjoyed doing this. And David, thank you for all of your questions.
Yes. Yeah.
And Benchmark, thank you for hosting this.
Very good. Have a wonderful evening wherever you are.
Thank you.